Good morning. Oh, come on. Good morning.
Good morning.
How are we doing this morning? Hallelujah. Wonderful to be in God's house. And we've come to do what? Praise. Praise His name. Worship Him. Magnify His
Amen.
Name. Amen. Oh, it's wonderful. Hallelujah. It's going to be a hot time in the house of God today, right? Glory. I sense His presence already. Isn't God good? I tell you something. We had a tremendous time in Bible study this morning. The presence of God was so rich. Oh, I tell you. My. You can get it through Zoom. You can come in person. We got a lot of room. A lot of space. You don't have to be afraid. Nobody's going to breathe on you. Amen. We're going to get the breath of God. Oh, come on, church. Hallelujah. Praise God. Father, we come before You in the precious name of Jesus. So thankful, Lord God, that we have access to You, that Your ear is bent low and Your hands are extended towards us always. And Lord, we have come to magnify Your name. Lord, we just want to give You praise and glory, Lord God. Our faith, our hope, our trust is in You and You only. And Lord, we want to pray, Lord God, for the Lawrence Vocational School. Lord, they're up and down, whatever is going on, someone comes, they don't know if it's going to open. Oh, God, have Your way. Lord, have Your way, oh, Lord God. And our children need school. You know all about it. Lord, we need a supernatural, heaven-sent, sin-killing, red-hot revival. Lord, we need, Lord God, for You to intervene, Lord God. Lord, we pray for our nation. We pray, Lord, instead of bitterness and evil and strife, God, we need to love one another more. We need Your love, Lord, to flow. Oh, God. Lord, we just want to tell You again, we love You and appreciate You. Have Your way in our midst. Lord, Your presence is so real. Lord, I know none was going to leave the same we came, having touched by Almighty God. And all God's children said,
Amen.
Amen. Let's just worship the Lord. Morning.
Test, test. There we are.
There we are.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
I am glad that you're here today. It's good to see you here in the house of God. We're going to worship Him today as a family. It's good to come together, even though we have to sit 6 feet. Tell you what, let's greet each other by waving. Everybody turn around and wave to somebody. Say, hey, it's great to see you today. We're going to worship God together as a family.
Hello.
Even though we're separated by distance, we still love each other. Amen. And we love our God together. We're going to praise Him.
Oh, if you've been walking the same old road for miles and miles, if you've been hearing the same old voice, tell the same old lies, if you're trying to fill the same old holes inside, there's a better life. A better life. Sing that again if you've been walking. You've been walking the same old road for miles and miles. You've been hearing the same old voice tell the same old lies. If you're trying to fill the same old hole inside, I tell you there's a better life. There's a better life. You got pain, it's a pain. He's a way maker. You need freedom, saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. And we've all searched for the light of day in the dead of night. We've all found ourselves worn out from the same old mind. We've all run to the we know just unright. Oh, there's a better life. Yes, there's a better life. Oh, if you've got pain, he's a pain taker. Oh, you feel lost. Oh, he's a way maker. You need freedom, saving. He's a prison shaking savior. If you've got chains, he's a chain breaker. Oh, if you've got pain, he's a pain taker.
belong. He's a way maker. You need freedom, saving. He's a prison shaking savior. You've got chains. He's a chain breaker. I sing for all that you've done for me. Oh, you've done for me. Tell me, who breaks the power of sin and darkness, whose love is mighty and so much stronger, the King of glory, the King above all kings, who shakes the whole earth with holy thunder, and leaves us breathless in awe and wonder. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace.
This is amazing grace.
This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me.
Thank you, Lord.
All you've done for me.
Glory.
Who brings our chaos back into order? Who makes the orphan a son and daughter? The King of glory, the King above all kings. Who rules the nations with truth and justice, shines like the sun in all of its brilliance. The King of glory, the King above all kings. This is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. Lord, you lay down your life. I sing for all that you've done for me. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy, worthy, worthy. Oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. I sing for all that you've done for me. And oh, this is amazing grace. This is unfailing love. That you would take my place. That you would bear my cross. My Lord, you laid down your life. That I would be set free. Jesus, I sing for all that you've done for me. I love you, Lord. Thank you for what you've done.
sing my great Redeemer's praise. The glories of my God and King, the triumphs of His grace. My gracious Master and my God, assist me to proclaim, to spread through all the earth abroad the honors of thy name. Jesus, the name that charms our fears, that bids our sorrows cease.
The power of my sin. Oh, He breaks the power of canceled sin. He sets the prisoner free. His blood can make the foulest clean. His blood availed for me. Hear Him, ye deaf. His praise ye tongues, your loosened tongues implore. Ye blind, behold your Savior come, and leap ye lame for joy.
Hallelujah, Jesus.
I had 1,000 tongues to sing my Redeemer's praise. Hallelujah. Praises to your name. Holy, holy, let every tongue proclaim. Hosanna. Joyfully we live to you our sacrifice of, come on, give them a sacrifice of praise today. Hallelujah. Lord, we sing praises to your name. Holy, holy, Lord, let every tongue proclaim. Of praise. Hallelujah. Praises to your name. Holy, holy, let every tongue proclaim. Hosanna. Oh, joyfully we raise and live our sacrifice. Oh, sing one more time. Sing hallelujah. Lord, all praises to your name. You are holy, holy. So let every tongue proclaim. Hosanna. Joy. We lift to you our sacrifice of praise.
We worship you, Lord. Hallelujah.
More than just the words of our lips, oh God. Let our devotion to you, our commitment to you, be our sacrifice today. Our time, our energy, God, all of us belongs to you. You're worthy of praise and of glory because of who you are. I give you glory.
I give you glory.
Because of who you are, I give you praise. Because of who you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Sing that again. Because of who you are, I give you glory. Because of who you are, I give you praise. Lord, because of who you are, oh, I'm gonna lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you. Because of who you are, Lord, I worship you. Because of who you are, Jehovah Jireh, my provider, Jehovah Nisi, Lord, you reign in victory. Jehovah Shalom, my Prince of Peace, and I worship you because of who you are, Lord, you're Jehovah Jireh, Lord, you're my provider, you're Jehovah Nisi, Lord, you reign. Victory, Jehovah Shalom, my Prince of Peace, and I worship you because, oh Lord, I worship you because, yes, I worship you because of who you are, because of who you are. I give you glory because of who you are. I give you praise. Lord, all my praise belongs to you. Because of who, Lord, you are, I will lift my voice and say, Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Lord, I worship you because of who you are. Just because of who you are, I can put my trust and put my faith in you, God. Heavenly Father, we've joined together here, spaced apart, but in unity, because we know how great you are. But Lord, at least we've got a small picture of how great you are. And even that small picture in our limited understanding is worthy to give you all the praise because of who you are. And Lord, you are Jehovah Shalom, who brings us peace. Jehovah Nisi, our King who reigns in victory. And God, you are Jehovah Jireh, providing for your people. Lord, there are people here with needs. As Pastor Dick, Lord, is going to pray, I join in that prayer. Meet our needs today, God. Heal our bodies. Give us the finances that we need to work through this situation. God, in your name, because of who you are, I believe, God, that needs are going to be met today in the name of Jesus. Amen. Pastor Dick, would you come?
Amen. Jehovah Rapha, our healer. If you have a need today, well, just put your hand, raise your hand if you have a need today all over the sanctuary. God knows. He hears your cry. He knows what you're going through. He's here. How many believe he's here right now? Amen. Hallelujah. Let me ask you to do this. Just stretch out your hand toward heaven, toward God right now, and receive. You believe who God is and what he does. Amen. You need a healing touch, whatever it may be. Whatever it may be, there's nothing too big or too small that God isn't concerned about. So right now, I want you to receive your healing. Receive. Amen. Because God cares. God knows. Father, we come before you in the precious name of Jesus. That name that is above every other name. And Lord, you have said, Lord, ask anything in my name and I will do it. We pray, O Lord God, according to your will. But it is your will to heal. It is your will to move among us as only you can. So, Father, pour out, O Lord God. Let healing flow from the throne of grace one more time and touch those that need a healing touch. Lord, from your throne of grace again, Lord, whatever the other needs that need to be met, oh, God, Lord, just grant it today. And I know all God's people will give you praise. Lord, will testify and said, look what the Lord has done.
Hallelujah.
Look what he's done. He's healed my body. He's put me in my right mind. Oh, come on, church. Hallelujah. We magnify you, Lord. We're going to give you praise right now as we receive whatever you have, whatever I need is. Lord, give him praise right now. Children, come on. Give him praise right now. Thank him right now. In Jesus' name, we accept it, Lord. We receive it in your name. And, Lord, we're going to call it done by faith. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. You may be seated if you can. Do we have any newcomers for the first time today? Anybody here for the first time? Anybody at all? All right. Well, they're missing out on a nice cup of... And let me just show it anyway. For those who are going to look by way of Zoom, we got a nice coffee cup for you. Is that a draw? And God's word, our daily bread. Listen, and we have a lot of our daily bread left on the table there. We have more. Take one home. Every day you want to read it. I mean, you know, it's about 15, 20 minutes. It really is great. My wife and I, most of the time we read, from here, and then we start to having a discussion. And how many know my wife always wins? Praise the Lord. Amen. Praise God. Isn't God good? Give him glory in the house. Praise God. Let me leave you with some announcements this morning. Our church bulletin is available each week online. Just go to the church website and click bulletin or scan a QR code when you come into the sanctuary. Amen? So it's here for you. On Tuesday night, prayer meeting has reopened in the sanctuary. Everyone is encouraged to come and pray here on Tuesdays at 7 p.m. Everyone should bring their own mask. Wednesday Bible study continues online using the Zoom app. If you'd like information on these meetings, you can contact the church office or check out the church bulletin online. Riverside has many discipleship ministries available for children, teens, and adults. Please contact the church office or go to our website for more information. Amen? Praise the Lord. Pastor Dan's going to come, I believe, and break the bread of life. Glory.
Good morning, everybody. It's good to see you. Missed you last week. I was visiting a pastor in Beverly, who's pastoring a church that was planted a few years ago there in Beverly, and he's had some ideas and how he does his service. And I said, I think I'm going to steal some of those ideas there, Pastor Aaron, if you don't mind. And he said it was fine with him. And I love that we're able to just gather again. And I didn't know anybody other than the pastor. I didn't know anybody in that church, but we still worshiped together, and we were still family. And so that was kind of awesome. And I know a brother, my former student, Reverend Mike Caparelli, came last week and preached the word of God to you. Were any of you here last Sunday and heard Pastor Mike preach? He's a great guy, great brother in Christ. And we're going to just thank him. And I've already told him that some of you typed out some great reports of the service already, and I passed those on to him. Let me tell you what he did. When my son was recovering from surgery, he heard about it, and he ordered a meal for my son. He said, what's your son's favorite food? And I said, well, and so he ordered a meal for my son to be sent to the house. Isn't that nice? Isn't that nice, dude? Well, I will try my best when we bring guest speakers in to have them be nice dudes. All right? Well, the story is told of a young man in a shipping office. And the shipping office received a giant roll of bubble wrap. Don't you love bubble wrap? And so he asked his boss, he said, boss, what should I do with this huge roll of bubble wrap? And the boss was busy. He said, oh, just pop it in the corner. It took him 3 hours to pop everything in the corner. Misunderstandings can be funny. Obviously not that funny this morning. Misunderstandings can be funny, but they can also be dangerous. Today we will continue our series on hard questions. It has actually, and I counted them up, it has been 19 weeks since we did part two of our hard questions series. But I still think it's important for us to look at some of these hard questions, because our call for 2020 is still, I will go. Pastor Christoph was here a couple of Sundays ago, and he preached on a story, and one of his main points was, I will go. And he didn't know anything about our 2020 theme. In fact, he and I were in the lobby after service, and I said, Pastor Christoph, look at those posters above the front doors, and it says right there, I will go. So God is speaking to us continually about that theme of what he has called us to do for this year. We still, even though we're stretched out and socially distanced and masked up, we still want to focus on reaching out to our communities so that we can share the love and the truth of Jesus with them. And this question that we're going to look at today is about a misunderstanding of what it means to be a Christian. Let's pray. Father, through your word, speak to us. Through your spirit, speak to us. And as we hear, let us be willing to surrender ourselves over to you. Take our hearts, mold them into how you want us to be, because we want to follow you. Help us to follow your call. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So we're continuing to look at the hard questions that we sometimes are confronted with when we share the truth of Jesus with others. Our call is to reach out beyond our walls and share the love and truth of Jesus with our friends and our family, our co-workers, our classmates, and any others that God brings into our path. We want to reach the Merrimack Valley with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And most of us have responded to God's call with an upraised hand saying, I will go. And the greatest way to share Jesus with others is to share the story of what Jesus has done in your life. our story combined with the power of God's word creates an open door that the Holy Spirit will use to speak to the hearts of people we know, speak to the hearts of the lost, and compel them to come and experience Jesus for themselves. But sometimes in our role of sharing Jesus, there are additional obstacles that come into our path. And there are difficulties and questions and confusion that sometimes cause barriers to be built up as we're trying to share Jesus with others. Because of those barriers, people are unwilling to hear the good news. Certainly the Holy Spirit can break down any barrier, but the Spirit usually works through us. The Holy Spirit works through us in order to break down those barriers. So if you are willing to be used by the Holy Spirit, He can use you to break down barriers, walls that people have built up, and they say, I don't want to hear about Jesus, and they built these walls. But if the Holy Spirit works through you, God will break down those walls. These difficulties and questions and misunderstandings often present themselves as questions or even expressions of doubt, and those questions can be difficult to answer. In fact, we may even be tempted to just skip over that, or we can reply with pat answers like, oh, you just need to have more faith, or just read your Bible and everything will be okay. People who are opening their hearts to Jesus don't want just superficial responses. They really want the answers to those questions. They're looking for real answers. And these questions are hard sometimes because maybe we haven't considered them, thought them through. But if we're going to see our friends and our loved ones come to Jesus, we need to be prepared for hard questions that they might be struggling with. So that's why we're looking at some hard questions that we might be able to explain the truth of Jesus to those around us. So the hard question that we're going to be looking at today is a question about need. Sometimes people don't think they really need Jesus or don't need any more of Jesus. This barrier to the gospel exists when people think they're already Christians. So we don't need any more of Jesus. They say, oh, I'm already a Christian. I'm already a Christian. You don't have to tell me about that stuff. I'm already a Christian. See, the problem is, though, they have a mistaken idea of what it actually means to be a Christian. Now, if you'll remember, what is our authority for what we believe and how we act? What do we stand on as a foundation for our authority? What are we today? Anybody got it? The God's Word, exactly. Good job. It's the Word of God. And a lot of people who claim the label of Christian are not Christians according to what the Scripture tells us is a Christian. Now, before I go any further, this is not about judging who a Christian is according to their behaviors. It's not saying, oh, you say you're a Christian, but you smoke. Or you say you're a Christian, but you wear short skirts. You say you're a Christian, but you voted for so-and-so. That's not what we're talking about when we're saying somebody is not a true Christian. But, you know, you might ask, Pastor, doesn't the Bible say we'll know people by their fruits? It does say that in Matthew 7:16. But we need to look at the context. Those of you who have taken my Bible Study 101 course, you know that we need to look at the context. So let's look at the context of that verse. Turn with me in your Bibles to Matthew 7, verses 15 and 16. Excuse me, I need a sip of water while you turn in your Bible. The health department says, I'm far enough away from you that I don't have to wear a mask, but I'm doing this in solidarity with you. All right? Matthew chapter 7, verses 15 and 16. All right? It says, and again, we're looking at the context of that verse that says, we'll know people by their fruits. Starting with verse 16, it says, beware of false prophets who come to you in sheep clothing, but inwardly are ravenous wolves. You will recognize them by their fruits. Are grapes gathered from thorn bushes or figs from thistles? So what was Jesus saying? He's saying, look, when people come and saying they are prophetic or saying that they are proclaimers of truth, what Jesus was saying was judge the message they give according to how their lives reflect that message. So if you've got someone coming and they're saying, oh, I've got a word from God from you, look and say, does that message match their lives? That's what the context of judging people by fruit is. It's not an instruction for us to judge the spiritual condition of your friend's heart. In fact, let's extend the context a little bit and go to the beginning part of that same chapter. Matthew 7, verses 1 through 4. It says, judge not that you be not judged. For with the judgment you pronounce, you will be judged. And with the measure you use, it will be measured to you. Why do you see the speck that is in your brother's eye, but do not notice the log that is in your own eye? Or how can you say to your brother, let me take the speck out of your eye, when there is a log in your own eye? So this is not about judging people's struggles or their outward appearance. This is about a misunderstanding of what it means to be a Christian. Okay, do we got that clear? This is not about judging people's spirituality. It's about a misunderstanding that some people have of what it means to be a Christian. See, anyone can call themselves a Christian. Anybody can call themselves a Christian, but that doesn't make it true. I can call myself a dentist, but that doesn't make it true. Now, maybe I define dentist differently than you define dentist, but still, it doesn't make it true. And in fact, I think the American Dental Association would probably have a few words from me if I started calling myself a dentist and opened up some office hours in my living room. I define it differently. Anybody who's seen a video about dentistry, well, now I'm a dentist. No, that doesn't make me a dentist. So in the same way, there are people who are defining Christianity incorrectly. And in those cases, they are operating under a false assumption that they are Christians. They don't have the biblical credentials of what a true Christian is. But to their minds, they're already a Christian, so they've got enough Jesus. So when you come and start sharing Jesus with them, they say, I don't need any more because I'm already a Christian. Now, here are some reasons people might think they don't need to hear any more about Jesus. Here's some excuses you might hear. They might say, I was baptized when I was a baby. Why do I need to know more about Jesus? They might say, oh, I'm part of, you know, such and such church. Why would I need to hear what you have to say? Or I once said a prayer to become a Christian in a church. Why would I need anything else? Now, none of those are reasons that they're not a Christian, but none of them is a guarantee that they're a true follower of Jesus. So let's look at these reasons one by one. First, baptism does not make you a Christian. Baptism just, it doesn't make you a Christian. It's important. It's a part of the instruction that Jesus gave to Christians to follow. Scriptural examples of baptism are people coming to believe in Jesus and following Jesus' instruction to be baptized as just the beginning of their true Christianity. Look at Acts chapter 10, verse 44 through 48. Turn with me to Acts 10, verses 44 through 48, if you have your Bibles with you. While Peter was saying these things, the Holy Spirit fell on all who heard the word. And the believers from among the circumcised who had come to Peter were amazed because the gift of the Holy Spirit was poured out even on the Gentiles. For they were hearing them speaking in tongues and extolling God. Then Peter declared, "Can anyone withhold water for baptizing these people who have received the Holy Spirit just as we have?" And he commanded them to be baptized in the name of Jesus Christ. Then they asked him to remain for some days. Look, this is what Peter is saying. Peter goes to this group of people and he preaches to them and they accept Christ and they begin speaking in tongues. And it's and some people are amazed. Well, man, these aren't even Jewish people. And here they are speaking in tongues. And what Peter says is like, look, it's obvious that they're Christians, guys. They are Christians, so we should baptize them. Not let's baptize them so they become Christians. They already were Christians because they already received the baptism of the Holy Spirit. Excuse me, I'm flailing my arms around and knocking off my microphone. So Peter is saying, look, it's obvious that they're Christians. They should be baptized, not be baptized so they can become Christians. So having been baptized, especially if someone was an infant and didn't even make their own choice to be baptized, being baptized doesn't make you a Christian. Second, being part of a certain church doesn't make you a Christian. They may say, oh, I'm a Catholic, or I'm a Baptist, or I'm a Methodist, or I'm Assemblies of God. But that is a label. And labels don't necessarily affect your heart. Labels is something you put on the outside. I can take a can of peas, take off the label, and put a new label of a can of corn on it, but that doesn't change the fact that it's still peas on the inside of the can. Unfortunately, there are churches who will teach you that if you accept their label, if you're part of their church, that makes you a Christian. But again, that's not biblical Christianity. It can be great to belong to a specific church, but that doesn't make you a Christian. Becoming a Christian makes you part of the capital C church, the church universal. We are part of the body of Christ. But being a part of a specific church doesn't make you suddenly into a Christian. Third, being Christian isn't about just saying a prayer. Most often it's the beginning of our Christianity. But having said a prayer in the past doesn't make you a Christian, because Christianity isn't about words you say. Christianity is about a relationship with Jesus Christ. Let me give you an example. Marriage is not simply the vows you made at the ceremony. I mean, you say these vows, but the vows are not the marriage. That's just the promise of what is to come. You're saying these vows, from now on, I'm going to honor you. From now on, richer or poor, I'm going to be with you. Those are the vows that you're promising for the future. And saying a prayer at an altar or in a pew, and you say, Jesus, come into my life. Those are important words, and it can be the beginning, but that's not the Christianity. Christianity is what you take and follow Jesus after the prayer you've said. That's just the start. So in the same way, saying a prayer to become a Christian can be a start, but the relationship, just like a marriage, must be maintained. Turn with me to 1 Timothy chapter 6. In 1 Timothy 6, Paul writes to Timothy, and he's describing biblical Christianity and what it's all about. So 1 Timothy chapter 6, and beginning with verse 12, we're going to read verses 12 through 16. This is what it says to Timothy. He says, Timothy, fight the good fight of faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. So there's the prayer. There's the beginning. There's the altar for Timothy. He's saying, you remember that time? You were there. You made that confession of faith. Now he continues in verse 13. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, to keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will display at the proper time, he who is blessed and only sovereign and only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in the approachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. This is not a quick prayer to receive a get-out-of-hell card. Christianity is not just about saying, okay, whoo, I've said the prayer, now I'm cool. Look, Christianity is about relationship, and any relationship, you need to maintain the relationship. But Pastor, once I'm saved, doesn't it mean I'm always saved? Be careful about misunderstanding that phrase. Now, once we are saved, listen, once you have accepted Christ into your life, nothing can separate us from his love. That's what the Bible says. Nothing can separate us from his love. Nothing outside of you can take away your salvation. Nothing is that powerful to take away your salvation. But you can reject your salvation. And let me give you an example. Who here was born in a different country and you came here and became an American citizen? Raise your hand if you're born somewhere different. Okay, I see lots of hands. Now, if you decided, okay, you know what? I'm going to go back and live in that country I was born in. Or maybe it's not even that country. Maybe you say, you know what? I think I'm going to go live in Canada or Australia or wherever. And you say, now, if you decided you're going to live there from now on, do you get to keep your American citizenship? No, because you've decided I'm not going to be a citizen of the United States anymore. I'm going to be a citizen of Australia or Spain or Portugal or wherever you decide to go. You're relinquishing your American citizenship if you leave. So in the same way, Christians can once again turn to serving themselves and being overcome by the world. You can say, you've got citizenship in the kingdom of God. But you can choose, just like you can choose to give up your American citizenship, you can choose to give up your heavenly citizenship as well. Turn with me to 2 Peter chapter 2. Peter's going to give some harsh words here about those who choose to reject their citizenship in the kingdom. 2 Peter chapter 2, and we're going to begin with verse 20, as you see there on the screen. This is what Peter says. For if after they have escaped the defilements of the world through the knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, they are again entangled in them and overcome, the last state has become worse for them than the first. For it would have been better for them never to have known the way of righteousness than after knowing it to turn back from the holy commandment delivered to them. Peter's saying, look, if people choose to leave their salvation and leave the kingdom of God and say, I'm going to go live for myself from now on, I don't want to hear about Jesus anymore, Peter is saying, look, they were better off in the first place, because in the first situation, they hadn't rejected Christ. They were at least still open. But now that they've rejected Christ, a wall has been built up, and it is even harder for them to come back to Christ. So yes, nothing can take away our salvation, but we can give up our salvation. So that excuse is sometimes given as well. Well, I prayed for salvation. I'm always saved, right? That's not the way biblical Christianity works. In biblical Christianity, it's a relationship that you have to maintain. It's a relationship that continues. Now look, it's a two-way relationship. God gives us the power to maintain this relationship. He has done the work to build this relationship already. But we can walk away if we so choose. So when facing the barrier of a friend or loved one saying, I'm already a Christian, it is best to explore what they mean when they use the word Christian. Is it the biblical definition of what a Christian is? Because the biblical definition of what a Christian is pretty simple. Turn with me to Romans 10:9, and we'll show it to you. Romans, some of you already know this verse. You've memorized this verse, and that's good. Romans 10:9. It says this, and you can see it here up here on the screen. Because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord, what does Lord mean? Lord means he's in charge. Just doesn't just mean, oh, you know, he's really great. It means that he's in charge, and that's repentance. It's saying, I'm not going to follow myself anymore, God. I'm going to follow you. If you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you'll be saved. It's a simple, simple formula for becoming a Christian. It's turning your life over to Christ and making him Lord and believing in him. It's simple, but it's not easy. To declare Jesus as your Lord and to give him your life, to turn away from living for yourself and begin living for him, like I said, that's repentance. Lots of people believe, lots of people do the second part here, but few make Jesus their Lord. But that's Christianity. And that is the truth that we are called to share. We are called to tell people what being a true Christian is. So, in concluding, let me remind you that this is our commitment. I will go. If we do not go, the call might go unanswered. And people will not hear the truth of who God is and what it really means to be a Christian. And we're surrounded by people who need the truth. They're in our workplaces, they're in our schools, they're in our homes. They walk by us on the street. They sit 6 feet apart from us at the coffee shop or on the bus. But their need is a matter of life and eternal death. Without Christ, they face an eternity separated from him. And they can't come to Christ unless they hear about him. And they can't hear about him unless someone tells them. And you are the best resource Jesus has to share with them. You might think, me? I'm the best resource? Certainly you can come up with somebody else that's better. No, you're the best resource because you're right there. You're near the person that God wants to bring that message to. Many of these people are laboring under a false security. They believe that they're already followers of Christ. They're already Christians, they think. But their assumption is based on a false foundation. Their foundation is built with feelings and traditions. But understanding what it means to truly be a Christian should be based on the foundation of the Word of God. God isn't looking just for people who will love him. God is looking for people who will follow him. People who will commit to him with a heart of repentance so they can receive the gift of forgiveness and salvation that he offers. The gift that was paid for by the sacrifice of Jesus upon the cross. We as God's followers, as his children, have a responsibility. We need to go and reach those who are in danger. In danger of an eternity separated from God, the God that they think they know. So how can we help them? I encourage you to build relationships with those who are still on a journey of understanding so that they are comfortable in discussing spiritual things with you because you have shown yourself to be kind and accepting because you took that journey as well. You might have been 5 years old, you might have been 50 years old, but someone walked with you on a journey of faith and understanding, and they told you what Christianity was all about, and they told you how to follow Christ. And I bet they did so with a voice of love rather than a voice of shrill condemnation. So I encourage you, be an example of love. Be an example of Christ to others. Show love, show meekness and grace and strength and all those things that Jesus has shown to us. It's a tall order to be an example of Jesus, but we don't have to do it alone. You have power available to you through the Holy Spirit to be a living testimony of who Jesus is. So how do you apply this message today? First of all, I ask you this. Have you been mistaken about what being a Christian is? Today is the day that you can change that and give your life over to Jesus. Jesus stands ready to accept you just as you are. Believe in him. Repent for the forgiveness of your sins. And you can discover a true relationship with Jesus Christ. And we're going to pray in a moment. I'm going to ask those of you, if you feel that you have mistaken what salvation was all about, you didn't understand what being a Christian was, today is the day. Now you know that it's more than just a prayer. It's more than just belonging to a church. It's more than just being baptized. It's being a true follower of Christ and maintaining that relationship. Second question I want to ask you is, have you stayed when God has called you to go? If you have been staying and you have people all around you, friends and family, and they have not heard the truth from you, I encourage you to seek the gift of the Holy Spirit to empower you to live as a witness. Accept that call of God, because he has placed a call upon you to go, to live as an example of Christ to those who are seeking him. Would you bow your heads in prayer with me? Heavenly Father, your hand upon our life is what has kept us going and kept us in our relationship with you. There are times that we haven't followed the call, certainly not as well as we should have. I ask that you would speak to our hearts. And if there are those that are here today that have had an incorrect idea of what Christianity is all about, I ask that today they'd be willing to say, yes, I will become a follower of Jesus. I will not serve myself any longer, but I will turn around and give myself over to you. Lord, convict, speak to them right now. Right now, Jesus. I'm going to ask right now if there's anybody here and you say, Pastor Dan, I feel the Holy Spirit speaking in my heart. I didn't know what it meant to be a Christian. I was wrong before, but I want to be his follower now. I want to give my life over to him. If that's you, I would ask you, just can you raise your hand so I can pray with you? Everybody, you can keep your heads bowed and eyes closed. But is there anybody here that says, Pastor Dan, I thought I knew what a Christian was, but I don't. You can raise your hand right now. Anyone? Then let me charge you now to be the one to go, because there are people outside these walls that they could have raised their hands. They would have raised their hands, but nobody has told them yet. Heavenly Father, help us to be your witnesses. Father, let us pursue and seek after the baptism of the Holy Spirit until we are endued with power and able to be your witness. God, help us to be willing to go. Help us to put the needs of others in front of ourselves, the eternal needs of others in front of our own, so that we can share the truth of the gospel of Jesus Christ. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's been so good to have you here with us today. We're going to just remind you that we'll be taking the offering as you go. There will be a basket near the door, and ushers will be there. If you didn't bring anything, you can always go to the website, riversideag.com. And there at the top, there will be a giving link. And you can click that giving link and give your regular tithes and offerings, as well as offering our missions offering as well. And that will help us to continue to do what God has called us as a church, and to encourage you to grow and to go. So we're going to play a song here, and I'm going to sing along. And you can, as we begin to sing, you can start to file out. But first, we're going to pray for this offering that we're about to receive. Dear Heavenly Father, God, I thank you for your word. I thank you for your call upon our lives. Help us, Lord, to take this word out of this building, out of this room, and take it with us, bring it with us into our cars and back to our homes and to workplaces and to schools and to family members, and be willing to share what you have given us. And Lord, I pray for the offering we're about to receive. Use it for the kingdom of God so that others throughout this Merrimack Valley, throughout New England, our country, and our world will hear the truth that you alone are God, that you gave yourself so that we could be your children. The offering we take today, God, it's going to be multiplied for that purpose. I ask your blessing upon the givers. I ask that the money we receive, God, as we use it for your purpose, God, it will be a sweet offering to you. In the name of Jesus we pray. Amen. God bless you as you leave. Thank you so much for giving and for being here today.
What a peace is mine, leaning on the everlasting arms, leaning, leaning, safe and secure from all.